Hello and welcome to Seeking the Divine. I'm Dr. Patricia Hill, and today my guest is Dr. Cynthia Bourgeau, who is the director of the Aspen Wisdom School and a well-known author, the latest of which is called The Meaning of Mary Magdalene. And it's really a very amazing take on a person who's a very mysterious character and very controversial in history. And you explode a lot of those myths in this book, don't you?
Yeah.
You have not done it in the same way as some of the other authors, such as Dan Brown, who tried to bring some of this information out, but in a fictional story. Your books address it on more of a theological level.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what can you tell us about this character who was known as a prostitute and a sinner throughout history and now seems to be getting a little bit different sort of reputation with more research? And I believe the Catholic Church has also retracted that title that they put on her as a prostitute.
Only barely.
Only barely.
Only barely. Yeah, that a lot of people believe in the Christian West anyway, that if you ask them who's Mary Magdalene, they'll say, well, she was the repentant sinner or the repentant prostitute who was healed of seven infirmities by Jesus and became his most devoted disciple. But this whole idea of Mary Magdalene being a whore or of even being wounded has little or no scriptural foundation. The idea that she was a whore was thrown into the tradition in about 594. Pope Gregory the First. That's first century or sixth century when he put together the various portraits floating around in the Gospels. There was this sinful woman. There was this woman who anointed Jesus. There was the statement in the Gospel of Luke that Jesus had cast seven demons out of Mary Magdalene, and Gregory's mind went ka-chung, 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 and came up with a portrait which has dominated the West ever since of the repentant sinner. And even today in some of the prayers for her feast day in the church, which is July 22nd, the prayers start out, O God who restored to Mary Magdalene to health, restore us to health also. But in point of fact, that's not the story that the scriptures tell. And in the Eastern Orthodox Church, she's still revered in the same way that she was originally, very originally in the West, as the apostle to the apostles.
Yes, that's quite a different position than being a fallen woman, a prostitute. She was actually in a very high position and was the beloved disciple.
Yeah, yeah. And in a high position, you know, what I've done, I've written the book from within my viewing platform as an Episcopal priest, and I've written it trying to go gently, to move people along, pushing their envelope, but not to just immediately stop the conversation dead in its track by jumping into, well, was she married to Jesus? Did they have children?
Mm-hmm.
All of that stuff. I say, let's take it piece by piece and see what we can establish. And we can't even establish definitely that she was noble or highborn or any of those things. But what we can establish very definitely is that she didn't abandon him. Like the male disciples all seemed to flee at the crucifixion. For some reason, she stayed put.
Mm-hmm.
And the scriptures all attest to this. It's right there in the Four Square Gospel. You don't have to read any kind of Nag Hammadi or Gnostic sources. She stayed put. She was there for the whole crucifixion, burial, entombment, and resurrection. So we know she did that. When you bring in just a couple of the more verifiably orthodox of the newer Gospels, the Gospel of Thomas and the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, you discover a little bit more that she was there not just because she, you know, she had a passionate crush on Jesus, but because she actually got what he was teaching, probably better than most of the guys, and was able to demonstrate it.
And it seems that because she did, there was some animosity towards
her.
Yeah. Which is possibly the explanation why she was left out of history in certain ways and labeled as a prostitute.
I think there's no doubt about that, that in the Gospel of Thomas, there's a very strong passage in which Peter, right at the end, says, Mary Magdalene should leave us because women are not worthy of this life.
That's a pretty strong statement.
Yeah, and of course it comes right out of the cultural conditioning of the era.
Well, definitely. They were in a very patriarchal era. Yeah. It was the Roman times. The Romans were very patriarchal.
Yeah. And it seems, you know, in a way, you have to be careful with what you say, because the Jewish tradition that this comes out of has a very, very strong history of strong, empowered women speaking their parts as prophets and as women of action right from the start.
Mm-hmm. That's really quite interesting. In fact, the Jewish tradition does honor the woman, the divine feminine.
It honors the woman in a lot of ways, and not just as a goddess or as an archetype, but in actual women that moved into places and did it. Mm-hmm. So there is a logical stepping stone between Mary Magdalene and the great other women of the Old Testament, like Sarah and Hannah and Deborah and so many of those who stood up and witnessed and helped. But it was still very, very unusual within the society for a woman to be a full-fledged spiritual teacher or apostle. And what you see in both the Gospel of Thomas and the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, you see Thomas and to some extent Andrew operating out of the cultural stereotypes, saying this is weird that he's empowering women so much.
Yes, what is this woman doing telling us what Jesus said?
Exactly, and Jesus' answer was very interesting. Well, he says, well, if you guys need to have her male, poof, I'll make her a male. You know, you want her a pig, I'll make her a pig. You want her a table? Because he says, what I'm really going to do is to turn her into an anthropos, a fully human being, because any woman transformed in that way will enter the kingdom. Mm-hmm. And presumably any man transformed in that way will enter the kingdom too, although he never says that.
Well, you talk a lot about dualism, and that is it's a dualistic concept, that the male and the female, and to become one, you do have to unite those things within yourself.
Yeah, exactly, at a very deep level. And over and over and over we see, particularly in the Gospel of Thomas and the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, and once we've got that viewing lens in place, you can see it all over the canonical Gospels, that Jesus came as a master of consciousness, calling us to a transformed consciousness and a transformed way of being. And that Mary Magdalene got what that meant, and she got the path that you had to follow to do that. And it was because she got it that she didn't abandon Jesus at the crucifixion.
And there is still the question about the relationship between them. They were beloveds, whether they were married or not. That is... that's not something that you cover in your book, but that they were very close.
Yeah, I think that there's no doubt when you look at the texts and the text between the lines and what's written out of the Gospels as well as what's in the other trainings, that they were intimate beloveds. And by intimate, I don't necessarily mean sexually intimate. I don't not mean that, but nowadays, when we hear the word intimate, we immediately say, oh, it means they had sex. What I mean by intimate is that they were involved in a dynamic, reciprocal, and mutually nurturing relationship in which they saw each other as equals and loved each other into being. The same as we know in our own intimate relationships today. And that one of the reasons that I've written this book is because for nearly 2,000 years, we've been putting forward the idea that Jesus was a celibate and that his power came from his celibacy.
And that's done a lot of damage, hasn't it?
It's done a lot of damage on the ground. It's absolutely wreaked havoc on our understanding of human sexuality and sexual responsibility. But it has also misrepresented the teaching.
Well, and it has also led to the formation of churches that believe that celibacy is the highest path, and we're seeing the fallout from that these days, aren't
we? Oh yeah. And it's based on an unprovable assumption, you know, that we don't have any evidence. As a matter of fact, it's hotly contested about what was What was Jesus' state? The church has routinely pushed the idea that he was unmarried, and that the first title that was given to him, and it's documentably given to him, the single one, in Aramaic, it's Ihidaya. And they say, aha, that proves that he was celibate, he wasn't married. But when you read the context clues in the Gospel of Thomas, it clearly means something like what we would call today the enlightened one or the master, the non-dual one.
Or the one who's non-dual.
Who had made the two
mm-hmm.
one.
Yes.
And that the passage which is often pushed from the Gospel of Matthew that says that Jesus was celibate and favored celibacy as the highest walk of spiritual life, when you take that text apart, as I do in this book, to begin with, he does not say that celibacy is the highest walk of life. He clearly says that mystical marriage is the highest part. And he says that those that can walk the celibate path, go for it. But nowhere does he say that it's the highest path, and nowhere does he say that he himself practiced it.
And what is mystical marriage?
Mystical marriage is, to put it in the words which he himself personally introduced into the ancient teaching from Genesis, the two become one flesh.
So that would be the male and the female.
Yeah. And the one flesh does not just mean when they have sex.
Mm-hmm.
It means that their wills, their hearts, their conscious personhood so grows together that they really become one being rather than two separate beings. They become what the beautiful British poet John Donne would later call an abler soul.
Well, I think that ideally speaking, that has always been the view of marriage, that the marriage should make the two become one.
Yeah. So Jesus was teaching a whole different path, and my insistence on bringing Mary Magdalene back into the tradition is not just to give her due time, but to really say that without her there and without an understanding of what was going on, we've significantly misunderstood the teaching of Jesus and how it works and where its power comes from, where its integrity comes from, and how it is intended to be used in our lives even to this day.
Well, that's good advice in general, I think,
mm-hmm.
and it's probably the essence of your teaching is that you must allow, you must let go, you must have give the space for
yeah.
more things to come in than you can possibly imagine
yeah.
with your clinging.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that's the message that's been at the heart of the Christian message. And as we've tried, like the older sisters in the story of Cinderella, to cram it into a shoe that it doesn't quite fit in, which is the shoe of that Jesus did this because his purity came entirely from his singularity as the only Son of God expressed in his celibacy, which is a model which is great for Jesus, but where does it leave the rest of us?
It leaves us all very confused.
Yeah, well, it leaves us having to come to church and have the church mediate Jesus to us.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not something he asked. He asked us to find it in our relationships, in our life, in where the rubber hits the road, in the little things, the
yes.
widow looking for her lost penny or the shepherd looking for his lost sheep, in our ability to engage with love in the things of this world. That's where we find it. And that's the message that's gone missing, and I think it's the message that Mary Magdalene holds the key to bringing back.
Thank you very much, Cynthia. We are at the end of our time. Our guest today has been Dr. Cynthia Bourgeau, who is the director of the Aspen Wisdom School, a well-known author, The Meaning of Mary Magdalene. And thank you all for joining us today. I'm Dr. Patricia Hill. You've been watching Seeking the Divine.